Well, good morning to you. So glad to see you on this Sunday morning. We come to the finale of our look at the seven churches of the book of Revelation. With seven churches plus an intro, it's taken us eight messages to cover it all. But hopefully you've learned something from it. What I intended was that you would see these seven churches as each individual churches with their own particular location and context, each one dealing with their own issues, and yet Jesus speaking to each one a message that they needed to hear. You know, the book of Revelation is one of those books that promises if you'll take time to study through it, there's a blessing. Remember chapter 1, verse 3, blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy. Blessed are those who hear it and take it to heart. I think that's true. Spend time with this book and there's a blessing. You recall how each message always said, whoever has ears, listen to what Jesus says to the seven churches. And that's what we've tried to do. Take each church and the message Jesus spoke, explain the message to them, but explain the message to us. Now, I've tried to give you a little bit of the historical background so you can appreciate a little bit more what Jesus was saying and to whom he was speaking, and hopefully we've learned from that. But as all things are, you finally come to the end, and we come to the last of the seven churches, perhaps the most famous of the churches because of how they're described by Jesus. We're talking about the Church of Laodicea, the lukewarm church. We're talking about Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. First, let me describe to you the city of Laodicea. We go back to our map. We're looking at Asia Minor, in those days called Asia Minor, but now we call it modern-day country of Turkey. Across the sea from Greece, you get your location there. We started with Ephesus, the first in the list of seven churches. As you start at Ephesus on the coast, you work your way up the coast on a major highway. You come to Smyrna. Going up further, and you'll come to Pergamum, just a little bit inland, about 15 miles, and then you start down a major highway in a valley. You hit Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia. You finally come to Laodicea, and once you hit Laodicea, there's a major highway that runs between Laodicea and Ephesus. It completes the circle. If you had someone, a disciple of John, who had the book of Revelation, the one single copy that existed, that disciple could start at Ephesus, the first city in the list, and just go in a complete circle in the order of the churches and read the message at each church, finishing at Laodicea, and then go back to where he started, back at Ephesus. Now, Laodicea itself is in a great location. It's a beautiful area. I've been there. If you go there, the city is located in a valley, but it's a very rich and lush valley. Got a water supply. Got fields and such as that. And then it's got mountains on both sides of the valley that just give it a pretty view. Laodicea was famous back in those days as the place where people with money like to live. They can do their business in whatever city they want to do business and commute back and forth, but Laodicea was the place to build your house. And so it was, they were noted for having bankers. Now, bankers were significant back in this time period because they're the people that had the real money. Anybody who's running a business, making money off that business, eventually becomes wealthy, and Sardis had a lot of wealthy people in it. But you know, it's the guys that loan the money to those businessmen, that's the guys really making some bucks. And so the bankers, the money lenders, as they would be in those days, they were people that had some money and power. And a lot of them in this region like to build their homes in Laodicea and then commute from there to all the different places where they did business. And so they were noted for their wealth, particularly for the bankers. Now, in addition to that, if you go there today and you look and see the ruins of this beautiful city, there's not a whole lot of ruins to see because what you get there is they got a whole bunch of rubble, but not a whole lot that they put back together. I'll show you an example of a picture. You see all the stones there. They've uncovered a lot of stones, the former stones that make up the buildings, the walls, the streets, but they haven't done a whole lot of reassembling. Another picture, you'll see once again more of the rubble, but if you look in the distant background, you may see some of the green valley back there, plus the beautiful mountain vista that you get to look at. Give you one more picture where they did put together a little bit of an artwork, and if you look through it on the other side, you can once again see some of the rolling green hills. It's a beautiful place, and that's where those people with money built their homes. Now, in addition to the money, they also had a little small medical college. And the medical college particularly focused on two treatments, with the ear and the eye. They had developed ointments that they could apply inside the ear or even on the eye. It would work with bacteria and infection and things of that sort. And so that's what this place was noted for. One more thing they're noted for, I got a chance to see it when I was there. They raise sheep with black wool. Now, you know, anytime you talk about white wool that you dye a certain color, it's going to lose its color as it fades, as it gets washed. But if it already starts with that natural coloring, that's a strong point. In this case, the sheep there are with the black wool, which made that then a very expensive and nice thing to have when you're making clothing. Because black's always the cool, distinguished color. And now you got garments made out of that black wool. And so these people thought they had it made. Lots of money, lots of wealth. And they've got their little medical school and the treatments there. They've got the black wool. There's a lot of good things about this city of Laodicea. Now, something else Laodicea is noted for is their two neighbors. If you stand on the location where the old city was and look to the west up there on the top of the mountain range, that's the town of Colossae up there. Now, Colossae, you know, from the New Testament because the book of Colossians, Paul's epistle to the church of Colossae, it was sent to that church up there, neighbors of Laodicea. Now, if you look the opposite direction, up on a tall mountain there, you get Hierapolis. And the New Testament does refer to the church at Hierapolis. Now, you got the city of Laodicea with a church, and then a church over in Colossae, a church at Hierapolis, these three churches close to each other, they're neighbors. Hierapolis is the interesting place to me. It's the more fun place to visit of the three. If you go to Hierapolis, they were noted then and today for their hot springs. I got a picture for you of the hot springs. You got the hot water with the mineral elements, the chemicals that are in that, natural chemicals in it. It comes out at the top of the mountain. As it begins to flow down the mountain toward the valley, it forms pools. There are dozens of these little small pools where that warm hot water sits there, and people would travel there so they could soak in it. They imagined that it had medicinal value. It probably did. And so you could soak in that for a while and just enjoy it. And, of course, a nice, warm flavor. You see that looks like ice crystals there. Those are not ice crystals. That's the chemical deposits as it solidifies over time. It's kind of like in if you're in a cavern and you got the stalactites, the stalagmites, that dripping that has solidified. That's what you've got here, a lot of that kind of thing. Now, you see in this picture, you sit in one of those pools, you got a beautiful view. You're looking out in this big valley, the mountain range in the background. It's a great place just to sit and to soak. Give you one more picture showing you people still do that to this day. And you can roam freely and hit any one of the pools and just sit there and soak. Now, if you're looking at the picture thinking, wow, that looks kind of steep and dangerous, what kind of crazy person would venture out far into that? Let me show you an example of what kind of crazy person. I was there, and when we got there, they have a nice resort hotel up in Hierapolis area, and so stayed overnight, and a snowstorm hit, snow and ice. Next day, everything was iced over, slippery just walking sidewalks, walking on the pavement, but still, we had to go across the street and go to the spring so we can get in that hot water. And where the pools were still, then it froze over. Where there was movement, then you had the possibility to kick off your shoes and get in there and start wading around, and we could explore the different pools and just enjoy those hot springs. The hot springs were a big draw in this area. They still are to this day. Now, those wealthy people down in Laodicea, oh, they love those hot springs for soaking in. And they could go up there and do that. But they also decided to build an aqueduct. And the aqueduct brought the hot water down to Laodicea. Of course, you know by the time it arrives, it's not going to be as hot as it was when it started. Well, it's going to be a little more lukewarm. You already got an idea of where this story is going. Tell you one more thing about the city of Laodicea, just to give you a picture of this wealthy city. Back in AD 60, they had a great earthquake. This region got hit hard, and a lot of the cities of this area got destroyed. And so the damage was such that they did in ancient times like we do today. You look to the federal government, want to know, can you get some federal relief? Well, Rome was willing to send money to these cities to help them rebuild. When they contacted Laodicea, Laodicea told them, no, thank you. We got plenty of money. We don't need your help. This is a city that's pretty self-sufficient because they've got the funds to take care of themselves. Now, as far as the church of Laodicea, the only other place we get to find out something about that church is in the book of Colossians. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 16, we discover that they received an epistle from Paul. Now, Paul says to the church of Colossae, when you finish reading this epistle, what we call Colossians, send it over to Laodicea, let them read it. And they've got an epistle, they've got a letter. Take the one they've got and bring it over to your church and read it. Now that raises a question. So where is Paul's epistle to the Laodiceans? It's not in our New Testament. Now, it's possible that Paul wrote several epistles that just simply got lost, never got collected with all the others. That's possible. I'll tell you another possibility. It could be it is in your New Testament. You just didn't recognize it. You see, one of the theories that's been around for a long time is that the book of Ephesians is one Paul's talking about. Paul could have written, for example, written to the church of Ephesus and then told them to share this like they always did. And so it'd go right down the highway to Laodicea. Now it's going to go up to Colossae and go around to the other churches. And so this passing around the epistles, your epistle that's in Laodicea very well could be what we call Ephesians. It has made its way to Laodicea. Now, in addition to that, we also know something else about this region. Paul apparently did not visit there. He knew the people, knew the churches, but he did not personally visit. Colossians says that. But he did know their preacher, Epaphras. Epaphras is spoken of in the book of Colossians. Epaphras preached for Laodicea. He preached for Colossae. He preached for Hierapolis. He had three churches. Now, he's going to be a circuit preacher. He's going to preach the word at all those different places. And so he's going to be your key leader for this region. Not much more I can tell you about the church of Colossae, let alone Laodicea or Hierapolis. So, that being the case, let's get into the message to the church of Laodicea. In verse 14, Jesus begins, like he always does, he identifies to whom he's speaking and who's doing the talking. So he says to the angel of the church of Laodicea, and then he identifies himself. I'm the Amen. I'm the faithful and true witness. I'm the ruler of God's creation. Now, as always, when Jesus describes himself in the opening, he will later use that in the message. In a few moments, I'll show you how that's used. Now, what's he want to say to the church of Laodicea? I will tell you, it's not good news. It's bad news. This is a church that's got some real serious issues. And so Jesus begins with the bad news. He talks about their worthless deeds. Their worthless deeds. Here's what he says to them. Verse 15, I know your deeds. You're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were one or the other. No, you're lukewarm. And because you're neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. Now, that's the words that are familiar from the messages to the seven churches. We all know about this lukewarm, spit you out of my mouth. And actually, that's imagery you can identify with. Most of us in this room, we know something about the way we like our drinks served to us, whether it be coffee or tea, or maybe even your soft drinks. For example, with soft drinks, we like it cold, ice cold. It gets room temperature, lukewarm. It's not as much fun to drink. You know, with coffee and tea, we like them hot. Hot coffee, hot tea, that's pretty good. Or we'll even take them cold. Starbucks will serve the iced coffee. And of course, we love our good, sweet, iced tea. But let it get to room temperature. It's just not as much fun to drink. When I was in Costa Rica, I toured one of the coffee plantations where they make the coffee beans for some of the exclusive coffee joints like Starbucks. And you get to see from start to finish. That's a lot of fun to see the process. We get to the end of the tour, we get to do the coffee tasting, which was great. I was looking forward to it. Had our little cups, get to try all the different coffees. But the deal was they served it to you cold. I thought that was odd, but they explained it to you. They said that the reason we serve it cold is because you get your best flavor if you drink it cold. Your taste buds will pick up more of the richness of the flavor, and you can tell the difference between them. Now, hot's also pretty good, they said, and most people like it hot. But he said the heat actually takes away some of the flavors. The cold is actually the better for getting the taste. But they said right there in the middle, that's not worth much at all. That sounded like Book of Revelation. I'll spit you out of my mouth. Well, that's the way it works as the church of Laodicea is described by Jesus. I wish you had something to your church. I wish you had some fire, some passion. I wish you were hot, wish you were cold, a little bit of kick. No, you're just kind of lukewarm. There's nothing there. Now, keep in mind, this is the city that has the hot springs that everybody travels to. They talk about those hot springs, how great they are, but by the time they come down the mountain and cross the aqueduct, they're not hot there. Lukewarm. And if you want the real benefits of the hot springs, you've got to get some fire and wood and crank it up and get it hot again, or you're just not going to get the full effect. This is a church that's missing the full effect of being a church. This is a church that's missing out on what it means to be Christ's church. Because there's just no fire, there's no drive, there's no passion in this church. They're just going through the motions. Now, that's not all that Jesus says to them as he describes their condition. He continues. He says, you say to yourselves, oh, I'm rich, I don't need anything. I got everything I need. I don't need anybody's help. Remember how the city said the same thing? We got plenty of money. We don't need anybody's help. You say, well, I'm rich. I'm not lacking in anything. Jesus says, here's what I say. I say that you are wretched and pitiful. In my eyes, Jesus says, I see you as poor, as blind, as naked. Think about how that hits this church. Laodicea is famous for his wealth, all the money, the bankers. Jesus says, yeah, you got a lot of earthly wealth, but spiritually speaking, I see you as poor. They're famous for having the eye and ear treatment, those ointments that would make their eyes be able to see. He says, yeah, you got that, but in my mind, you're spiritually blind. And they got that nice looking black wool that they wear, looking pretty sharp. He says, yeah, but I look at you, I see you spiritually naked. Now, Jesus says you need to do something about that because what you've got is a situation that just cannot last. It can't stand. Because what we have here is a spiritual complacency. But spiritual complacency, they can't even see it. Now, I find it interesting at the church of Sardis, Jesus found some good people in that church, but he said, but there are some among you who have fallen asleep. They need to wake up. Church of Laodicea, he doesn't even talk about any good. There may be some good there, but he doesn't mention anything good about this church. He just simply describes the church as you're poor, you're blind, you're naked in a spiritual sense. You're lukewarm and I spit you out of my mouth. You know, there's a message for me and you and for every church. And that is this, we gotta be careful. Always be careful that the passion we had at the beginning is still there today. You know, it's so easy when you become a Christian to be excited about salvation, excited about Jesus, excited about being a part of God's people. But at some point, if you're not careful, that excitement starts to fade. Next thing you know, you become lukewarm. There's no real drive, no real passion. You got to watch out for that. We all got to watch out for it because it happens. That's why the New Testament time and time again warns us to take a spiritual inventory, periodically do a checkup, see where you are, see if you need to crank it up again. And you know what you're looking for? It's the same things that the scriptures talk about time and time again. The same things I talk about in my messages. You got to watch for those key indicators of whether you've got some life and vitality, you're just going through the motions. I always say, for example, you want to check all those things that really matter, the things that matter not just now, but matter for eternity. What kind of things are you looking for? I look at your communication with God. Look at your prayer and your scripture reading, because there's your two-way communication. Prayer is where you talk to God. You just unload your heart, and scripture reading is where God talks to you and says what he wants to say to you. Sometimes in our life, what we'll find is I'm in one of those lulls where I don't pray much, except maybe a quick word before I eat a meal, but that's about it. You're not having the heart-to-heart conversation with God. And scripture reading, I get the little piece Pressley throws at me each week, but I don't know I'm doing much more than that. Folks, if that's you, maybe you become lukewarm. You need to crank it up again. I always say, look at the other things. For example, are you looking beyond yourself to try to be a help to others? Yeah, that's always a sign of spiritual health, is when you care about others and want to reach out and make a difference. That's service. That's ministry. And we saw examples of that this week with Vacation Bible School here. Had a great program. Looked like the kids enjoyed it. I think the adult volunteers enjoy it as well, because you know, you come and help people like that, you serve people and you see their excitement, it's contagious, and you feel like you did a good thing this week. We always have a lot of opportunities in this church to do things that aren't for me, they're not for me and my family, they're reaching beyond me to try to help others and make a difference in the lives of others. And if you're doing that, good for you, that's a good sign. If you really haven't been doing much of that anytime soon, maybe you become lukewarm. I always say, look at Jesus in the Gospels, his teaching, because he'll always talk about the things that you really need to be checking on, make sure you're contributing what you should to the kingdom of God. He'll talk about your time, your talents, your treasure. Look at your time. Is time pretty much for you, or do you take the piece of it and give God a good, healthy portion of your time? And your talents, your abilities, are you using them not just simply as your own resource, but you also reach out and use them in ministry and service for the benefit of the kingdom? And your treasure. So much of what we take in is for us and our families and our needs, and that's good, but do you also take a good, healthy portion and use it for the kingdom of God and his work? He would always tell you, look at those things. As he says, where your money is, that's where your heart is. And so it is, you look at those kind of indicators. They give you some idea, are you still passionate for the Lord and for his service, his kingdom? Or have you become lukewarm? There's other things we could talk about as well, but I think you get the point, don't you? We start off strong. And we've got our good periods in our life where our spiritual life is really clicking. But sometimes it becomes complacent. And if we're not careful, we're lukewarm. And Jesus says, "I'll spit you out of my mouth." Well, here's a church, Laodicea, that needs a revival. And sure enough, that's what he talks about next, their spiritual renewal. It's time for a spiritual renewal. So he says to them this. He says, "I'm going to advise you. I'm going to give you counsel. I counsel you to come to me and buy a gold that I have refined in the fire so you can be rich. I counsel you to come to me and buy this gold that will actually give you the wealth that you say that you have." Think about that. Here's a city that's got wealth as far as material possessions, but they're spiritually poor. Come to me and we can make you spiritually rich. He says, "I advise you to come to me and buy white clothing so we can cover your nakedness." Oh, they walk around their fancy black wool, but he says, "But I see you as spiritually naked. Come to me and we can dress you up with white and purity." And he says, "Come to me and I'll give you an ointment that can treat your eyes so you can actually see." Oh, they've got eye treatments for physical blindness, but I'm going to take care of your spiritual blindness. See, the solution to their problem is they need to come back to Christ. They need to come back to Christ in a very strong, passionate way, and then we can take care of these weaknesses in your life and in your church. Now, in giving them that, Jesus is coming down hard. Oh, he's hitting them hard. And he says, I'll tell you why. He says in the next verse, he says, "Those I love, I will rebuke you." See, parents say that. Grandparents say that. The reason I'm coming down hard on you is because I love you. I want you to grow up and be a good kid. I want you to grow up and do right. And so it is, Jesus says to this church, "I'm coming at you hard. But I rebuke you in this way because I love you. I want you to get serious. I want you to repent." Now, let me tell you a little bit about this repentance story in the seven messages to the seven churches. As we go back and look at our seven churches once again, of these churches, there are two churches that Jesus does not call to repentance. There's no criticism. There's nothing he says you need to work on. There's two churches. He just simply commends them for their good work. We're talking about Church Smyrna, church number 2, and the Church of Philadelphia, church number 6. Those two are small churches, but they're doing it right. They're doing what church ought to do. On the other hand, the other 5, they're the ones that have some issues. Now, he may say, "I like this about you. I know your deeds, and this is a good thing." But he'll then say, "But I have this against you." And so for Ephesus, the big city church, "Oh, you're doing great, but you're still lacking in love." Or he'll say to Pergamum and Thyatira, "Oh, yeah, there's some good things there at your church, but I still have this against you, the way you've compromised with your culture." To Sardis, "Oh, you've got some there that are walking in white and doing the right thing, but some of you have fallen asleep. You need to wake up and repent." And then Laodicea, the last one. And you folks need to wake up and get some passion back in your soul once again. 5 churches that need to repent and get back on track. Now, as Jesus comes down hard on the church of Laodicea, he'll finish on a soft note, a gentle and compassionate note. Here's what he says to him in verse 20. "Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone will hear my voice and open up the door, I'll come in and I will dine with you." Boy, those are words we cherish because we've used those words ever since. Those are words that inspire us when we're talking about the gospel, evangelizing this lost world, people that are lost and need Christ. And the gospel message we share with them is like Jesus knocking on the door of their heart. And all they need to do is just open up the door and Jesus is ready to come in and make a difference in their lives. They just got to open that door. We use these words as well when we're thinking about spiritual renewal and revival. Here are Christians who have become complacent. They've become hardened. But if they'll just open the door of their heart, Jesus says, I want to come in and we can get things going again. When I was a kid growing up in my little small church, I remember that up front they had that famous picture many of you probably have seen. The picture of Jesus standing at a wooden door, knocking on the door. It comes from this passage. I stand at the door and knock for every one of you. I'm there. I'm knocking. I want to come in. I want to be with you. Will you open the door and let me in? Well, I find that the church he rebukes the hardest is also the church that he gives that compassionate invitation. I still want you. I still want you to be in my family. So will you repent? Will you open the door of your heart? And let me come in and make a difference. Now, when Jesus finishes this message to Laodicea, he does the same thing he does with all of the churches. He ends on a high note, a heavenly hope, I call it. And so he says, okay, whoever's got ears to hear, will you listen to the message that the Spirit says to each one of these churches? See what you can learn from the messages. And he says, to him who overcomes, to the one who's faithful and true and stays the course and make it all the way to the end, to the one that overcomes. He says, I got something for you. I'm going to let you come and sit with me on my throne. Just like when I was victorious, I came and sat on the throne of my Father. Oh, you see the symbolism there. To be invited to come and sit with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that's a symbol of victory. That we have come to the winning side. We've been faithful and true in this life, and now we've come to the winning side. And that's a good thing. Which reminds me of what Jesus said in the beginning of this message. In the beginning of the message, he said, I'm the Amen. I'm the one who is faithful and true. You know, those words just standing alone mean something, but think what they apply to a church of Laodicea. Laodicea is the church of the bankers, the money lenders, the people that dealt with finances, a finances that comes and goes between people. You know, it's no surprise that in the banking industry, in the finance industry, we talk about trust and fidelity. Because people give money to an institution, we expect it to come back one day when we call upon it. And an interest that comes with it as well. And that institution will loan money out and expects it to come back to them at some point. And thus we have our promissory's notes and we have our agreements and we have our trusts and this and that. And you see, Jesus says, I know you guys are in the business of trust and fidelity, but I tell you, if you want to know somebody whose words you can trust, somebody whose words are faithful and true, and everything he says, that's me. I'm the faithful and true, the one that when I tell you to do something, you can trust it to be true. And I'm the Amen. And I like that because that's the word you say at the end of something. It means, so be it. Yes, it's true. So we put it at the end of our prayers. You know what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20? He says that God made a lot of promises in the Old Testament. But then he sent Jesus, and Jesus is the yes to every one of God's promises. He's the one that makes them come true. He's the Amen, Paul calls him, because he's the last word of God, the final word, the word that makes it so. This is Jesus speaking to this church and saying, I advise you, I counsel you to do what I say. And if you do, and you overcome, one day I will invite you to come sit with me. In this life, if you are faithful and true to me, then when you die, I'll be faithful and true to you, and I'll invite you to my home. That's the message to Laodicea. That's the message Jesus has for me and you as well. To live this life passionate for Christ. To live this life giving him everything we promised him in the beginning we would. To live our life for him. And knowing that as we serve him faithfully in this life, oh, he's got something great waiting for us in the next. Because he's faithful and true to the very end.